All right. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Equitable Grading, Reducing Biases and Increasing Student Success. My name is Lin Nguyen. My pronouns are she, her. And today in this workshop, we will highlight three essential pillars for equitable grading, and they are accurate, bias resistant, and motivational. These pillars are taken from the book Grading for Equity by Joe Feldman. And in the follow-up email, I will put the name of the book as well as additional resources for your reference. So I've been teaching chemistry for more than a decade, both here at Northern Illinois University and at the institution. My classes vary in size from 6 to 200 students. And since I started teaching at NIU in 2016, I have interacted with a lot of students. And that because I'm responsible for teaching the Gateway General Chemistry course, which used to cap at 200 students per section. And I have many stories from these students over the years, and I will share some of these stories with you today. Our students, Northern Illinois University students, are very diverse, and they face different challenges, and they do not come with the same social capital. So they need different opportunity for development. And this is the result of diversity, diversify in our recruitment, which is commendable. However, our graduation rate is still quite low. It's about 45 to 46% average over 6 years. At this rate is even lower for Black student at 30%, while white student have a graduation rate at about 60%. So I hope that some of the thought-provoking ideas that shared today will spark a transformation in your grading practices, and ultimately it will benefit the growth and success of our student. So a little bit about me. Like I say, my name is Lin Nguyen. I am an inclusive teaching coordinator at the Center for Innovative Teaching and Learning. Although new to the professional development field, I am an award-winning educator with over a decade of teaching experience. I have a PhD in computational chemistry, and I am an immigrant, and you probably can detect an accent from my English. So from an immigrant with no money, no connection, no education, no English language development whatsoever, now I have become a champion for equity in a classroom and in a community. And I'm very grateful for you to be here with me today. So, now I'd like to learn a little bit about everybody here. I noticed we have probably some people like Kristen. I noted that your email from NIH. So I wonder if we have some new faculty coming in. So in the chat, or you could unmute and share your name, your discipline, and what do you hope to take away from today's discussion? And I budget a couple minutes for us to do this. So whatever your communication style, if you want to speak, please unmute yourself. If you would like to type in the chat, please do so.
I can go maybe first. My name is Abdul Azad. I am from the College of Engineering, and I teach in electronics area. And for this course, mainly to learn about what's happening in this field. So I know that grading equity is a burning issue nowadays. So we want to see what's happening, what I can learn from here. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate you sharing. I appreciate that you being here with us.
Yes, my name is Christian Mbulu. I'm from Nigeria. I'm finishing up my postdoc with the National Institute of Health. I also work at National Institute of Health. I'm trying to go into teaching. So I just finished my postdoc. So I'll listen and see what I can take away from the class that will help me out.
So are you coming to NIU or looking to?
I'm going away from NIH. Been at NIH for more than 20 years. So I finished my, so I'm going to public health teaching.
I see. So in the chat, we have Bonnie, sociology, and want to continue to learn and meet the needs of my diverse student population. Thank you for being here, Bonnie. Deborah, English, try to new form of grading. I've used rubric for 30 years. I hope things have changed. Rubric is actually one of the form that we recommended for equitable grading. And I would love for you to share with the whole group more about how you use rubric in your grading. Let's see.
My name is Jane Rose. I am in Family and Consumer Sciences. My specialization is family studies, teaching about family relationships and working with family agencies around DeKalb. I've been in NIU for about, this is my 18th year, And so I'm interested in Equitable because I meant to attend it last semester, but I unfortunately, because I know the same was often, but I was not able to attend. So since I am here in the summer, I decided why not now? And I'm obviously an immigrant and I am interested, especially to look at how we can meet the diverse needs of our students when it comes to grading.
Thank you so much for being here, Jane. In a chat, I have Bill from Biological Sciences. Teach a few intro biology theory courses for major and non-major. The disparity of student preparation for college have been striking. And Bill, you're looking for best practices not to perpetuate harm or for the disadvantaged student. Thank you so much for being here, Bill. So Alicia. Okay.
Hi, sorry for joining late. My name is Alicia Prisky. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Political Science at NIU. I teach mainly courses on comparative politics and development in the Global South. So I'm always interested in kind of further practices to ensure that, you know, students from diverse backgrounds have equitable access to resources, to opportunities, and to ensure that, you know, practices in the classroom are implemented equitably. So wanted to join to learn more. So thanks for holding this.
Yeah, thank you for sharing and thank you for being here. And I have Bill Golden Key too, Bill from Music, have very diverse group of students. So yeah, so if you at NIU, you notice that we have a group of very diverse students, and that's why we're all trying to do our part to support our student learning and success. So thank you so much for being here. And we among ourselves, we have a very diverse group of different disciplines as well. So as I mentioned earlier in this workshop, I want to highlight three essential pillars for equitable grading: accurate, bias resistant, and motivational or growth focus. So I established three learning objectives for us for today. I would like to have a guide a discussion on how we could align grading practice with our teaching philosophy. So we spent some time discussing how your background, identities, and experience shape your teaching philosophy. And then after this workshop, I also hope that you'll be able to identify and implement some of the growth focus or equitable practices that we discussed today in order to create a more equitable grading system for your course. And then the last thing I would like for us to take away is how can we best measure student acquire knowledge and skill and not their compliance. So we will discuss policy for late assignment, what are some of the equity issues involved in late work, policies, particularly for our student population? And what are some examples of a more equitable way that we could address late work? So let's get started, dive in. So in chemistry, from my background, when in my training, they don't teach me how to teach. Like, we don't talk about teaching philosophy in my graduate school, in my postdoc experience, which it didn't discuss about teaching philosophy. So I want to give you a few minutes to think about your teaching philosophy, and let's start with think about if you have a best teacher and how they change your life. And so I want us to start thinking about teaching philosophy, you know, from our own experience, right? So we all come from different experience. We carry different also identities, some as given to us and some we acclaim for ourselves. So if you would just take the next 2 minutes or so, think about the best teacher that you have and how they change your life. And if you don't have one, that's fine too. But if you have one, I would love for you to share with the whole group. And once again, we could type in the chat, you could unmute yourself and share.
I would like to share.
Please, Jane.
My best teacher was actually a colleague whose class I sat in back in my country. She had come as an exchange teacher. So she was a Canadian teacher who came to, you know, to Kenya to teach in her class. And she didn't believe in students being themselves. And she offered an environment where we could all sit down on a round table because it was a small class. I was teaching, but I also wanted to attend her class. So she offered us an opportunity or a space where we could all sit down and face each other and be close to each other in a round circle and gave us a space and said, in this space, you can be yourself and you can share freely. First of all, she made all of us, you know, pledge to non-judgmental of each other and not to expect anything. So she just encouraged us to be ourselves. And because it was a graduate class, and most of us had already undergraduate, you know, and all that, it was a space where people, because in my country, actually, we have reference for teachers. So this one kind of came down to our level and just like became one of us and gave us room to explore and to be wrong and to not be perfect and not to, you know, and so, and not to be afraid of quiet moments when you have nothing to say. She'll just wait until, you know, so it just felt like a teacher who gave me space to be me, not judging me, not having expectations of me before I opened my mouth, but was waiting to hear what I had to say. And this made me feel like what I was going to say was valuable, whether it was right or wrong. So, and from that time, she mentored me into PhD program, you know, because that time I just had a master's. She mentored me into a PhD program, and up to this day, she has been my mentor.
Thank you so much for sharing that beautiful story. So it sounded like she has a great impact in you, your life, and your perhaps you're teaching philosophy because you know what it feels like to have a teacher like that. In the chat, I have Deborah share a little bit about an English teacher at Barnard College. Let's see. Oh, okay. And then Bonnie also share a teacher who makes learning fun. That's exceptional. So and I'm gonna share my story really quick. The professor that changed my life is a chemistry professor. I am an immigrant. I get to America as an adult. I couldn't speak English. And I'm the first generation going to college in my family. So I have no idea what graduate school is. So my analytical chemistry professor, he was my undergraduate research mentor. And he asked me, he told me like in one of our meeting, he's just like, you're better than all of my graduate students. Have you ever considered graduate school? And that my response were, what is graduate school? And then we have the discussion. And because of him mentioning graduate school, I apply, I got accepted, and I pursue higher education. So he changed my life. So that was just one of the story, but there's so many other story that we all have, and it impact our teaching and learning and our teaching philosophy. So I really appreciate that some of you that share your story here. So in the next slide, here's something that I encourage you to think about whether you already have formulate, develop your own teaching philosophy, or you just now start thinking about it. How do you view knowledge? Like, so in this slide, I give you a quote, two very different things, right? A philosopher and educator, Paulo Freire, famously described knowledge as a gift bestowed by those who consider themselves knowledgeable upon those whom they consider to know nothing. Right? So that one way of thinking about knowledge transferring. Another way to think about it is knowledge is socially produced, a more complex and social process of knowledge making through interaction, collaboration, and negotiation. So that the second way of viewing knowledge is associated with feminist pedagogies. And in their rejection of traditional view of teaching and learning as a one-way process, they want to emphasize inclusivity. So they recognize that knowledge is socially produced and view teaching and learning as a more complex and social process involve interaction, collaboration, and negotiation. So in this way of viewing knowledge and teaching, we strive to include students in knowledge community rather than placing them outside of it. So student and teacher ideally learn with and form one another, co-constructing knowledge, just like the way Jane described her teacher, her professor that did in her class. So if you have a teaching philosophy, would you like to share with everybody here? Or if you would like to share a little bit about what your thought when you think about your teaching style, your teaching philosophy, do you feel more related to the first one where knowledge is a gift bestowed, you bestow on your student? Because that the way you were taught, the way you will learn, or you start to see more knowledge is socially produced and you want to invite your student into the learning community where you facilitate their learning experience. Second one, Bonnie say second one.
I think I am an in-between. If it is a continuum, mm-hmm. It's a continuum of knowledge on the first one to the other one. But I am more like three quarters halfway towards the knowledge that is socially produced. But there is a place for knowledge where the professor, you know, knows just a little bit more than the student.
Yes, I love it. I love that you recognize it's both, right? It's not just one thing or the other. It's everything, like most things. It's complex and messy. So Bill say that I've been working to integrate other way of knowing, borrowing from oral tradition and First Nation tradition. Yeah. The second one, bring in voice of student from any culture. Yes. And Bill, I know you teach biology, so it's really challenging because my background in chemistry, and I know that the first one is how I learn and how I taught for a while. So Bill, if you're comfortable sharing a little bit more about what you mean by borrowing First Nation tradition in your teaching, that'd be great. But yeah, don't feel like you're on the spot if you don't want to speak.
Sure. Sorry, I'm in a sweatshirt today. I'm freezing for some reason. I'm maybe fighting off a cold. Anyway, thank you so much for hosting this talk today. So I've been reading, and one of the most relevant to biology recently has been Braiding Sweetgrass. I'm a plant biologist by training, and so this book goes through how the author, who is a trained botanist, integrates multiple ways of knowing into the biology classroom. So it's somewhat controversial, I'm not gonna lie. Not everyone is super comfortable with this. So we can talk about science in terms of the formal methodologies that have been accepted with Western science. I think one of the challenges, even in my intro bio course, is where the students have really come alive and become interested in is the stories where science is evolving, where science is discovering something new, where science is pushing the boundaries and breaking the norms of what is known. And the students really love to hear about what is, you know, what is left to be done. And so having this kind of third or second space out there, you know, I find that, sure, we can talk about what is known, but by having this other category of what's unknown, we cannot actually, I find the students are much more engaged. So having that oral tradition, what do they know? What can they bring into the classroom? What is their experience with this biology? Sure, I can go into the details of what we understand, but it's much more interesting to allow them to put it into their voice. That's something that I'm working for, is having the students bring this back to their world. So it's a work in progress. So, and I'm here to
thank
learn
you.
How
it's
to grade
so very
that.
Progressive. Yes, and fascinating. Thank you for being the leader in STEM in term of revamp the way we teach in STEM field. I really appreciate that.
Well, I think it's really necessary. So thank you for hosting.
You're welcome. So just something for you to start thinking about if you have not, but if you already have, then good. I hope you continue to work on your teaching philosophy and how your identity and experience inform and instruct your teaching practices. So the first learning objective that I had is for us to align grading system with teaching philosophy, right? So ask yourself, what do you want your grades to represent? Do you want it to evaluate the acquisition of knowledge and skill, or evaluate compliance? So sometimes asking out loud the question really helped me when I try to come up with a different way to grade. And then the second question, I hope you consider asking it, what do you want grading to accomplish for you? Do you want the grade to inform your instructional decision? Whether you need more review in a topic, or you can move on to a deeper and more complicated topic? Or do you want the grade to inform your feeling? You work really hard, prepare this wonderful, informative engaging lecture, and then you deliver it and the student didn't get it, and it reflect on the grade and you feel disappointed. So think about what you want your grade to accomplish for you. And the third question that I suggest you think about is what you want grading to accomplish for your students. Do you want the grade, the grade that the student received, you wanted to incentivize their learning, make them feel good, motivate them to learn more and continue to study harder and learn more? Or do you want the grade make student, like incentivize student for compliance? And we will spend some more time talking about compliant, and I should pick one topic, and is attendance, like whether we should grade attendance or not grade attendance. But I hope the three questions are something that you consider doing when you develop your grading practice. So like I say, I pick attendance because it's, oops, I don't know why I do that. Should we grade, should we not grade attendance? And that's entirely up to you and your course, right? Because if you're teaching a course that requires students to show up, attend class so they can debate each other in real time, then maybe attendance grade is necessary. And if that's the case, then I hope you consider the three questions that I just present. What do you want the attendance grade to represent? Do you want it to represent the, to evaluate the acquisition of the knowledge or skill or both? Or do you want to evaluate compliance? The second thing is, what do you want attendance grade to accomplish for you? Inform instructional decision or inform feeling. And the third one is, what do you want attendance grade to accomplish for your student? Incentivize learning or incentivize compliance. And I put the image right here. Every picture in this color depict things that my student have told me. So there were medical emergency, death of a loved one, court order, unexpected change in work schedule, issue with law enforcement, breakup, divorce, mental health problem. And like I say, I've been teaching chemistry for over a decade, and I taught 198 students per section. So I get to interact with a lot of students, and I'm very genuine and honest with my student. I bring my whole self to the classroom with my social identity and speak freely about how I'm an immigrant and first generation college student. So I gain my student trust. And so they share their story with me. And some of these stories are heartbreaking. And I'm just going to give you an example. So I had a student who told me that her brother were in prison and he had a child, and the mother of the child just passed away. So now at 18 years old, she become the primary caregiver of a toddler, and she a freshman at NIU. So she apologized for being behind attending class and completing classwork. And my heart just like, I tell her that, how many extensions do you need? What do you need? How can I help you? I put her in touch with the family coordinator at the NIU Child Development and Family Center to help her arrange child care for the baby, the toddler that now in her care. And so this story as an example of student with different racial, social background. Let me share with you another story. So I have another student who was a veteran and a primary caregiver of his father, who's suddenly diagnosed with brain cancer. And he's a very responsible student, but he hesitated to ask for help. He hesitated to ask for attention. He felt like it's unfair to other students. So I reach out to him and I assure him that I would dare to help all students. I offer him extension and I told him that I would do the same thing for anyone in similar circumstances. So it doesn't matter what the student race are or social background, they face different challenges. And when you make class policy and practice it equitable, it benefits everyone. and everyone will succeed. So how should we address equity issues such as these? Why not penalizing students because we assume they're just lazy or unmotivated? So something to think about, and the three questions I find it very helpful for me when I develop my grading practices. And I hope that it's going to be helpful to you as well. So I'm going to pause here for just a second and want to ask, when you grade, what are the most important thing you want in this case for attendance? Do you grade attendance? And if you do, what is the most important thing you want your attendance grade to accomplish for your student?
I have a question though before we you know answer that. So do you have a attendance policy on your syllabus?
So I try everything. So at first I didn't take attendance, and then there was some study come out and people pushing how using attendance a bonus extra credit point to incentivize student attendance. So I tried that too, and then that didn't work out well. But I never grade attendance, but I have tried to give attendance point a bonus or extra credit. And then because of the pandemic, when the way we teach and learn changed completely, right? So because I am a working mother, and during the pandemic, I have to work from home and I have two young children. So this situation inspired me to take drastic measure. So I decided, I already created the first online asynchronous course for the chemistry department here at NIU. And now when everybody come back to in-person teaching, I use the asynchronous online course for my in-person classes. So for my in-person, for my online student, I tell them that they have the option to attend my in-person class. And for my in-person student, I tell them they have the option to join the class virtually, or frankly, they don't have to attend class at all. So we have some non-traditional student who they take a look at my Blackboard course and they sent me an email and they say, oh my God, I never seen a course like this. It looked like an asynchronous online course. Like I can take your course without showing up to class. And I tell her that, you know what, you are right. And so I get to the point that I have to tell myself when student, I have a big lecture hall, Friday 143. And so in the past, I would have it all fill up. And now I would have it with just a center, front and center with a group of about 25 students to 30 students. So I have to constantly remind myself that I did it intentionally. I gave my student the option to attend, watch the video and use my asynchronous online course so that if they don't show up for class, they don't get hurt. So I have to remove my ego and keep reminding myself that this is good. These students want to come here because they want the direct interaction with me. And we develop a very close relationship, me and the group of about 30 students. But then overall in the class, everybody, the success rate of everybody improving, and I see a closing in the equity gap. So that's my story with attendance.
My name is Abu Lazad. I want one thing to ask you, that how I know you just mentioned your course is working well, and how much students actually following your class on their own? Are they good in time management and things? So what I found that in my classes, that type of class what I teach or some of us teach here, that students will be happy with this asynchronous classes, but sometimes they fell behind the timelines and things, doing things, and sometimes physical presence of explaining things as a person, I feel I may be wrong, that's why I hear from all of you, that much more impactful. And I can see that their eyes, whether they're getting the point what I am talking about or not. if needed, I can go over the same thing again, maybe by watching their face or some asking question. But having some asynchronous class, I cannot have that feel. Or maybe your nature field course is good, it works, but for my our area, sometimes I feel a little bit of lost. I'm talking on black hole and where it's going. I do not know. So in-person class is much more effective for me, which I feel. This is one thing. And the other thing, I do not give any grade, any point for being in the class, but I have got very heavy attendance rule. They cannot miss more than certain amount of classes. Of course, I take care of any unusual cases, which you mentioned one or two, which we face also. So of course, I talk and deal with them individually, given the nature of problems they have in their life. So I wanted to hear from all of you how you feel or how you see or think. Thank you.
Yeah, I really appreciate that you share that. I am one of the students who I have to show up in class. I have to learn in person. I do not do well on asynchronous online course, and I'm not gonna lie. I can do a little bit better on synchronous online with the instructor live and can answer my question, but I do best in person. So I think I agree with you. It depends a lot on your course, the content, the structure, and also it depends on the way that you deliver information and the way that the student take in information too. So I think what I'm doing it because my course is introductory level. So it's not upper division.
And also I just making you break here, sorry for that. I also feel that sometimes big group of our undergraduate students are not good at managing things their own. When they're coming from high school, they need some human touch and things. Coming to the class on time, they know that they need to be class. Teacher will ask things if needed. But if we leave them their own, they might fall behind. And at the end of the time, they feel, where I am going now, all of those things happen more often for this kind of classes, basic classes than higher. So that's I think that okay, please go ahead.
I absolutely agree with you. Like a high school student probably needs some structure and some guidance so that they can learn time management. But at the same time, if we could remember how diverse our student population are, and we have a large population of non-traditional students as well, student who are adult and come back to school. So I think in every situation, you should have to consider to be willing to adjust and I mean, you clearly care about your student, right? So you can work with your student and decide what best for your class, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that is true. I think, of course, I also mentioned that I take care of those unusual cases as well. If
yes.
anyone having some,
yes,
and each term, our classes are not that big, but each term there are a few, one or two cases where some unusual things. But our goal is to maintain to deliver the content of the course properly. And if that goal has not achieved, then we may be failing to some extent.
Yes.
So that's how, but this is a broad issue, of course.
Right.
Please go
right.
ahead.
Right. So I'm going to go over this slide really quick because I realize we have a really good discussion, which is great, but I have to be mindful of the time. So I'm going to go over this really quick. So I want to encourage you to think about grading for equity is growth-focused grading. And focusing on the three pillars, accuracy, equity, and excellence. So we don't have to compromise quality when it comes to being equity-minded, right? Being equity-minded, I tend to put the word excellent with equity because I think equity is not grading minority or underrepresented student differently. It just is a more complex issue. It's a grading that focuses on accuracy whether students learn the skill or the learning objective and not to focusing on the compliant. So I skip this one real quick, and I want to jump into the learning objective number two, some of the growth focus practices for you to consider. So with that, the first thing is aligning your assessment with the learning objective and grade by the learning objective. So this will involve assessing whether the student are acquiring the course objective or standard, rather than receiving point for simply completing the assignment. And then the next thing to consider is distinguish homework from busy work. So our students are busy, we are busy, right? So be intentional about your homework. I tell my student why I want them to do what I want them to do and how their activity or exercises often with repetition will help them acquire and retain the learning objective and the skill that necessary for their career. So I often tell my student, I ask them if they play a musical instrument, if they participate in a sport or even playing video games. And then I tell them that all the activity require practice and practice. So you want to be good at playing a musical instrument, practice. You want to be good at sport, practice. Or even with video game, you want to be good at playing a video game, you have to practice. So same thing with chemistry, they got to practice. So so be intentional about your homework and make sure the student understand why you make them do it and how do you grade it. Extra credit. This is another subject that over the year, I have given different type of extra credit because students keep asking for them. And then later I decided to let go, like I'm stop doing extra credit. Instead, I try to think of something that I learned over the year is if you could separate the labor-based activity and the learning objective-based activity. So there's activity that would help students learn the objective for that module or for that lesson. And then there's a labor base where if they do a little bit more, if they better at time management, they can earn A or B. So the labor base kind of helped me distinguish my A student from my B student. And then the learning objective or the standard base would ensure that my student learn the learning objective for that module. So the third thing is content acquisition and not behavioral management. So you want to ensure the grade reflect what your student know, whether it's the learning objective or a skill, and try to distinguish that you're not just measuring, you grade to measure student compliance. So should student be getting a grade based on how compliant they are, or should they be assessed based on their mastery of the course objective? And then when you evaluate student participation, so not just attendance, assuming that they attend class, now you want to evaluate or grade student participation, I think it's important to be mindful of potential biases. So for example, some students might find it difficult or uncomfortable to maintain eye contact or to raise their hand and speak up during the class. I never raised my hand during class when I were an undergraduate student because of my English. I don't want the other kids to laugh at me or make fun of my accent. So even though I know the answer, I will not raise my hand. And to this day, because of my nature as an introvert, I would speak during like group share. So if I am in a group of just like two or three people, I would speak up. But if you ask a question in big group, I will not speak up, or it would take me a long time to muster the courage to raise my hand and speak up. So if you do grade participation, think about all those things. And then the next thing that I hope you consider is retake, resubmission, and revision. So if you want the student to learn the course learning objective, right, maybe require student retake if they earn below certain grade. This would encourage students to continue the learning process rather than just earning a poor grade and move on. This way, it's a one possible strategy, but students who fall below mastery or do not demonstrate that they achieve the learning goal, then they have to take another look at the course material. They have to continue with the learning process, and then they have to retake the assessment to determine whether they have progress. The new grade would replace the old grade, not average, because that would depress growth. So in my course, I use a software-based homework tool. So I would allow students to have unlimited attempt, and I only take the highest grade attempt within the due date. So they can take the assignment multiple times, and the highest score or the highest attempt will be recorded. So for group work, we at CIDL, we provide a separate workshop on inclusive group work. But just one thing to consider, if you do provide group work, please consider provide individual assessment for group work and provide individual grade instead of the whole group grade. And it's a complex issue again. That's why it's have a standalone workshop. So you follow CIDL, future workshop, maybe you would be interested in attending the inclusive group work. The last thing I want to mention is value growth, not privilege or not value the student that have more access to resources. And this with their like be mindful that our students come with different background, different level of preparedness, right? So some it will take them more time to process, to catch up. And so if we value the distance that they travel and not their and not just value the amount of privilege that they already have, that would be good. So we have time for a quick reflection on growth. So just I invite you to reflect on these questions. How would the below practices affect your student grade? What if you weight more recent performance instead of averaging it over time? That one of the practices that could potentially reflect student growth instead of averaging, which is depressing growth. What if you allow students to retake and replay previous score with a better score, more current score? I put the letting go, I should have put letting go of my egos, because this is what I did. I have to let go of my ego, and I am very intentional about not grading behavior. And what if we don't assign zero grade? Because sometimes if you really want students to learn, if they miss an exam and they got a zero, they say, oh, school, is there nothing I can do? And then they just move on. They don't learn anything. But if you make them restudy the material and then retake the exam, then they have to study it. They can't just forget about it and move on. What if you use self-evaluation, peer evaluation, and allow students to write reflection on their learning journey? And then the last thing is a more progressive and drastic movement where people talking about ungrading, employing expansive feedback strategy other than grading. I'm not there yet. So that's just something that out there for us to think about. So any question, reflection anybody would like to share with the whole group? What's your thought? You can pick any of these strategies.
I want a little bit clarification on the last point you mentioned, employing expensive feedback.
So I would start with I don't think this is going to be happening anytime soon, because we still use GPA as a mirror to measure learning, as a mirror to measure student financial aid and scholarship. But there's a push, like, think about how if you have children, how when they go to preschool, they don't get a grade, right? They learn. And so when my daughter, she's four, or she tried to learn the letter, she didn't recognize the letter, she didn't get the F grade. She actually get feedback and then she get another chance. So for kids at that age, they don't receive a grade. They receive expansive feedback and then they improve and they continue to learn. And then they finally master what they learned for, in this case, the alphabet. So there are some people pushing for that type of learning and measuring assessment and replace grading, assigning grade entirely. Is that, I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, it answers. I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
So if
we're
we
not
do,
there
do,
yet.
We have, if we do do, I know this is not in place still now, but how you can, how maybe this is, time is not much to talk more on this issue.
Yeah.
Let's talk about others.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's something that I want to learn more as well. So I am actually looking more in ungrading, that's what they call.
We had an example of one mature student where all of us in the department had to kind of use that, the last one, because she, I mean, this person could not learn like everybody else. That doesn't mean that she was not learning. And we couldn't just follow what she couldn't come to class. We would give her an assignment. She wouldn't answer like everybody else. But at the end of the day, when you talk to her, she is making sense out of what you are teaching, but she is just not learning traditionally the way the rest of the classes. So we decided, as you know, me and a group of faculty, because we were all experiencing the same thing. So we decided, you know what, she is over 60 years old. She is not here to start her career or anything. So we will just see where her wisdom lies and we shall grade that. That she would have failed the class, but we decided no, there is a value, others are learning from her, you know, because she is mature, she is bringing a lot of wisdom, but she's just not following the traditional way of learning. And you know, she was really contributing to the class in her own way, so we use kind of the last one.
Well, I really appreciate you share that story. It's good. I'm learning from you, and I'm so glad that you and a group of faculty did that for this one student. Yeah, thank you for doing that. And thank you for sharing with all of us here. Okay, so similarly, if you have any policy for late assignment, I hope that you do ask what happened to your student and not so much of what's wrong with you, because this is from my personal experience. So our grading policy, if you would want to consider through an equity-minded lens when it comes to late assignment, and yeah, I'm sure there's some student that just like slap and forget to show up on final exam day because they overslept. But then in many other situations too, I learn to ask my student a question, what happened, instead of what's wrong with you. So just something to consider. Like I say, I do accept late work in the past. I accept late work with a penalty of 10% off per day, and then I eventually get, like, I didn't give them any late penalty, but I communicate clearly and often frequently weekly, I will share with the grade up this week because they have the same assignment, the same format assignment every week. And I will share this either average of the class and so that the student know where they stand. And I would give them a lot of encouragement and saying that if you do the module by week four, module four, that's when we have the first exam that covered the learning objective in module 1, 2, 3. If you already complete all the homework, then you learn and you will do well on the exam because the assignment prepare you for the exam. So I do away with penalty for late assignment. I accept late assignment, but I communicate often with students how the assignment can help prepare them for the exam. So some of the late work policy, some I just mentioned, other as you may want to allow extension requests if they have a legitimate reason. You might want to allow late passes or floating deadline or work in progress, or you can choose to provide optional or self-selected homework. And if you choose whatever practice that you choose, I do hope that you communicate clearly with your student why you choose that and how it's going to assist the student in their learning. Grading rubric. We have a session on grading rubric. It's a wonderful way to make sure that you communicate clearly about how you grade, and it's one of the strategies to help with equitable grading practices, and we do offer a separate workshop on effective communication and grading rubric. So I'm gonna, sorry I didn't get to hear, I think one of us use rubric to grade. Actually, you know what? I think we have a minute. Do you want to share with the group how you use rubrics in grading? All right. Right. Okay, let's see.
Particular person you wanted to share, or in just anyone?
Oh, I have a question here. You know, I know the one person saying they use rubric. So floating deadline. So are you floating deadline? So I set deadline every week. The student know that every week the homework gonna due at midnight on Saturday. But then at the same time, they know that I accept late work. So they know that there's a deadline, but at the same time, they know that they can submit the work late. So, and without penalty, but then at the same time, every week on Monday, I will share with the whole, I will send out an announcement and I share this year the assignment for this week, this year the high score, this year the average, and the percentage of the class that complete the assignment on time. So the floating deadline is, I have a deadline for my assignment, but at the same time, I accept late work and I don't penalize people for submitting late work. So we're running out of time here, but I hope that the different topic that we discussed today give you some thoughts to take away and think more about your grading practices and policy. And maybe you might want to consider implement some of the practices that we share here. I will send a follow-up email today with all the resources. And you can use them as a reference. You can always reach out to me or any CIDL staff to talk more about this issue. Okay, Deborah say, I establish what I expect in several area content, paragraphing, style document. Oh, I see. Those are your rubric. Perfect. Yes, I think it's very helpful in grading for the student to know what you're expecting. I'm going to stop sharing here and I will stop the recording. Thank you so much for being here with me today.